Hello, this is John Rauch, a scientist at Sartorius. Today I'll be presenting a poster titled Dynamic Live-Cell Visualization and Quantification of AKT Activity Using a Genetically Encoded Fluorescent Kinase Translocation Reporter. This poster was presented at the American Academy of Cancer Research Conference in 2022. Dysregulation of signal transduction pathways is associated with cancer initiation, progression, and recurrence. The PI3K AKT signaling pathway has been extensively investigated as a therapeutic target due to its mechanistic association with several hallmarks of cancer. Studying dynamic changes in kinase activity can be difficult, and assays to measure these changes in live cells in a physiologically relevant environment are lacking. Standard approaches to monitoring AKT kinase activity are limited to endpoint assays, which lack the ability to monitor the effects of treatments over time. The Incucyte Kinase AKT green-red Lentivirus reagent encodes a kinase translocation reporter based on a green fluorescent protein-tagged AKT substrate, whose subcellular localization is phosphorylation-dependent, and a red fluorescent nuclear protein to denote the nuclear cytoplasmic boundary. This enables analysis of dynamic changes in AKT kinase activity via a nuclear translocation ratio metric. By using the Incucyte Live-Cell Analysis System to monitor AKT activity, we can observe variable time and concentration-dependent responses to treatments targeting the PI3K AKT pathway. First, we'll look at live-cell imaging of AKT kinase activity. In this example, SCOV3 cells stably expressing the Incucyte kinase AKT green-red indicator were treated with AKT selective inhibitor MK2206. This results in the translocation of the green fluorescent sensor from the cytoplasm to the nucleus. As you can see here in the precompound condition, the signal is located primarily in the cytoplasm and not in the nucleus. After addition of MK2206, we can see how that signal moves from the cytoplasm into the nucleus. And at the 28-minute time point, you can see that signal is primarily in the nucleus. The kinetic graph on the left shows a decrease in the nuclear translocation ratio, or NTR, over time, indicating AKT inhibition. The red nuclear-restricted protein remains in the nucleus and does not change over time. As you can see in the image panel across the top, that red nuclear protein stays in the nucleus even after the MK2206 addition. This is primarily used to indicate the nuclear cytoplasmic boundary in our masking paradigm. Next, we'll look at concentration and time-dependent effects of compounds on AKT activity. A549 cells stably expressing the Incucyte kinase AKT indicator were treated with inhibitors targeting the PI3K AKT kinase pathway, including allosteric AKT inhibitors MK2206 and API1, competitive AKT inhibitors AZD5363 and apatasertib, and upstream PI3K kinase inhibitors LI294002 and PI103. The 96-well microplate graph on the left here shows time and concentration-dependent decreases in the nuclear translocation ratio for all compounds tested. So what you're seeing here is a 96-well microplate graph, and it's showing the response over that 24-hour period of time in every single well of that microplate. Addition, now we're highlighting two of these compounds, AZD5363 and LI294002. As you can see, LI294002 showed an initial decrease in that nuclear translocation ratio indicating AKT inhibition, but we can see over time that returns to baseline indicating a recovery from that inhibition, as opposed to AZD5363, which showed sustained inhibition of AKT over that 24-hour period of time. So this is how we can use the Incucyte and live cell analysis to measure these responses of AKT inhibition over an extended period of time. This is also supported by the live cell images. As you can see in the Li-294-002 treated wells, at 1.5 hours, we can see that that signal is primarily in the nucleus. However, at 24 hours, you can see it is now back in the cytoplasm, indicating an active AKT, so it is recovered from inhibition over that time period. However, in the AZD5363 treated wells, the signal is located in the nucleus at 1.5 hours and remains in the nucleus even at 24 hours, indicating sustained inhibition of AKT. Next, we'll look at effects of serum starvation on AKT activity over time. In this example, HeLa cells stably expressing the kinase AKT indicator were shifted into media containing no serum to remove various growth factors known to activate the PI3K AKT kinase pathway. The serum shift caused a decrease in the nuclear translocation ratio, indicating a decrease in AKT activity. While no change was observed in control wells maintained in 0% serum, as you can see in the gray graph here. After 4 hours, cells were treated with either 1.1 nanograms per mil epidermal growth factor, or EGF, or 3.3 nanomolar recombinant insulin growth factor, or R3-IGF-1. Both compounds induced activation of AKT as demonstrated by this rapid increase in the NTR seen here. R3-IGF-1 addition resulted in sustained activation over the 12-hour time course, while activation by EGF diminished over time. So this was a transient induction of AKT caused by EGF, as opposed to the sustained activation of AKT caused by R3-IGF-1. Representative images from all conditions are shown. Prior to compound addition, the sensor is located to the nucleus of cells in serum-free media and the cytoplasm of control cells in 10% serum. Upon activation by EGF or R3-IGF-1, the sensor translocates from the nucleus to the cytoplasm, as shown in the 4.5 hour images in the center. At 12 hours, the sensor returns to the nucleus as AKT activity decreases over time in the EGF-treated wells. While it remains in the cytoplasm of the R3-IGF-1 treated cells, as seen in the 12-hour image here, this indicates that EGF activation is transient, and over time, the AKT activity is decreasing, as opposed to sustained activation by R3-IGF-1. Next, we'll look at the kinetics of AKT activation by epidermal growth factor. Unlike in many endpoint assays, in our Incucyte Live-Cell Analysis assay, we can do multiple additions of drugs into the same treatment wells and monitor the activation of AKT after each addition. In this case, we're trying to see if repeated additions of EGF could cause additional activation. This would tell us if the EGF is being degraded in media over time, or if this is an actual biological feedback process causing this decrease in activation over time after EGF activation. MDA-MB231 cells stably expressing the Incucyte kinase AKT green-red indicator were serum starved for 3 hours to inactivate AKT. Cells were then treated with EGF or serum-free media control for their first addition. You can see the wells treated with EGF, which would be the teal, pink, and black graphs shown, show a rapid activation and increase of the nuclear translocation ratio. The control wells treated first with serum-free media, which would be the gray and purple graphs below, show no increase in nuclear translocation ratio, as AKT is not being activated. After 4 hours, each of these conditions were treated with a second addition. As you can see in the gray, the cells first treated with serum-free media were again treated with serum-free media, and no additional activation was seen in AKT as expected. The black graph shown are where cells first treated with EGF, and then a second treatment of serum-free media, as expected, showed no additional increase in AKT activity. Interestingly, cells first treated with EGF, shown in the teal here, were then treated with a second addition of EGF. And the graphs look very similar to the second addition of serum-free media, so there was no additional AKT activation by adding a second treatment of fresh EGF. Cells first treated with EGF, shown here in the pink, were then treated with a second addition of R3-IGF-1. Those cells showed a rapid activation of AKT by the second treatment of R3-IGF-1. This is due to AKT activation through a different growth factor receptor in IGF. Additionally, control cells first treated with serum-free media also showed a rapid activation when a second addition of EGF, as you can see in the purple graph. So this is indicating that this transient activation of EGF is due to a biological feedback process and not degradation of EGF in the media. Next, we'll look at monitoring AKT activity in PTEN knockout mutant cells. PTEN is a phosphatase known to dephosphorylate PI3K, therefore stopping the signal transduction in the PI3K AKT pathway. Cells with a PTEN knockout mutation are known to have constitutively active PI3 kinase and AKT activity. In this case, we look at HeLa wild-type cells and HeLa PTEN knockout cells. In the HeLa wild-type cells, you can see that AKT activity was reduced upon serum starvation and rapidly increased in response to EGF or R3-IGF addition, as we showed previously. While AKT activity in the PTEN mutant cells was minimally affected by both serum starvation and the addition of growth factors. Both PTEN knockout and wild-type stable cell lines were then treated with IGF receptor inhibitor lincitinib in the presence of 10% serum, which caused concentration-dependent inhibition of AKT in the wild-type cells, but no reduction of AKT activity in the PTEN mutant cells. This is due to the fact that PI3K is constitutively active in these PTEN knockout cells, so inhibiting the upstream IGF receptors had no impact on AKT activity. The AKT inhibitor MK2206 was added as a positive control, which acts directly on the AKT kinase. And in both the wild-type cell lines and the PTEN knockouts, we saw inhibition of AKT activity as expected. These observations are again supported by having the images. You can see in both cell types, in the MK2206 treated cells, the signal is primarily located in the nucleus, confirming that AKT is being inhibited. In the wild-type cells, you can see that with the 2 micromolar lincitinib, the signal is primarily in the nucleus, indicating that we are seeing AKT inhibition. However, in these PTEN knockout cells, the signal is primarily in the cytoplasm, as AKT is not being inhibited and is still active. This is compared to the vehicle controls in 10% serum, which contain active AKT, and our signal is primarily located in the cytoplasm in both cell types. Next, we'll look at how we can make concurrent measurements of AKT activity and proliferation by using the Incucyte system. Nuclear translocation ratio as a measure of AKT activity and red object count as a measure of cell proliferation were monitored concurrently in MD-MDA, MB231, and T47D breast cancer cell lines expressing the Incucyte kinase AKT indicator. Kinetic graphs of NTR, or nuclear translocation ratio, as you can see across the top here, demonstrate concentration-dependent inhibition of AKT by the selective AKT inhibitor, MK2206, in both cell lines. Measurements of red object count from the same cell lines, as you can see below, reveal differential effects of MK2206 on proliferation between the two cell types. So as you can see here, in MBA-MB231 cells, there was almost no effect on proliferation from the treatment with MK2206, despite the fact that we did see inhibition of AKT. However, in the T47D cells, we saw a significant reduction of proliferation, as you can see down here below in this graph. While we saw similar effects in both cell lines in AKT inhibition, only in the T47D cells did we see a decrease in proliferation. So this is an example of how you can use our system to look at both AKT activity and proliferation within the same assay. I see 50 grafts of red object count at 24 hours and nuclear translocation ratio at 72 hours are now shown here. The IC50 for AKT inhibition by MK2206 was similar in both cell types, as you can see in the teal IC50 graphs here and here. The IC50 for AKT, the IC50 for proliferation now was significantly left shifted in the T47D cells compared to the MDA-MB231 cells. As you can see here in the T47D cells in the pink, we see a fairly potent effect on proliferation, whereas our curve in the MDA-MB231 cells is fairly flat as proliferation is not being inhibited. The protein synthesis inhibitor cyclohexamide was added as a control compound. This would inhibit cell proliferation without affecting AKT activity. And you can see in both cell types, we saw similar effects of no effect on AKT activity or our nuclear translocation ratio, but a significant effect on proliferation as shown in the red object count graphs. In conclusion, by using the Incucyte Live-Cell Analysis System combined with the Kinase AKT reagent to monitor AKT activity, we can observe variable time and concentration-dependent responses to treatment with inhibitors targeting the PI3K AKT pathway. The Kinase AKT reagent can also be used to study activation of AKT. After 4 hours of incubation in serum-free conditions, cells treated with growth factors displayed variable AKT activity profiles over time. HeLa cells with the PTEN knockout mutation maintained high levels of AKT activity in serum-free conditions. In contrast to wild-type HeLa cells, which exhibit a decrease in AKT activation upon removal of serum. This was confirmed with representative live cell images. Concurrent measurements of AKT activity and cell proliferation can be made by monitoring the nuclear translocation ratio and red object counts over time. While both MDA-MB231 and T47D breast cancer cell lines exhibited AKT inhibition by MK2206, differential effects on proliferation were observed. The Incucyte Kinase AKT Lentivirus reagent provides valuable kinetic measurements of AKT activity using live cells within a physiologically relevant environment. Thank you.